It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question, I guess, today to the Deputy Premier, Acting Premier. To the Acting Premier, and you look down the whole row. It's a good question for you, actually, because over a month ago, we worked together to clear the decks, to move aside legislation that was clogging up the system so we could clear the way for a plan for job creation, to grow our economy and encourage investment. That was a month ago, House Leader, but unfortunately, since then, I feel the Premier's reneged on our deal. You've not brought forward any job creation initiatives, but you brought forward new ideas, for example, to bring in labeling on McDonald's menus and a new 24/7 dispatch service for animals when you can't even run Orange for human beings. Minister, where's the jobs plan? How did this get on the agenda instead of what was promised to the PC
government? Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I think our record speaks for itself when it comes to job creation in this province.
I will go straight for the individual. The member from Lambton, Kent Middlesex, come to order. Thank you. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, Ontario has created 475,600 new jobs since the recession, meaning we've recovered 179% of the jobs created compared to the USA at 78% and the UK at 127%. Mr. Speaker, we could talk about our comprehensive youth job strategy, which is already allowing youth across this province to access the types of experience they need so that they can find jobs. But you know, Mr. Speaker, I want to focus on one piece of legislation that's before the legislature right now.
Answer.
Bill 105, which would lower taxes for small business, and ask the Leader of the Opposition why his party continues to delay the passage of that bill.
Thank you. Supplementary.
The minister says that the record speaks for itself. You're precisely making the point that I am. Minister, yesterday the finance minister stood up and he said that the Ontario economy is slowing, that we need to once again lower our expectations. If I hear that and see that, that tells me that you're doing something wrong, not more of the same. Let me give you some examples. You promised that the Green Energy Act would create 50,000 new jobs. Well,
wrong.
You're wrong. I ask you, where are those jobs? You promised the HST would create 600,000 more jobs. You're wrong. I ask you, where are those jobs? I'm proud the PC caucus has brought forward a comprehensive plan to make Ontario number one in job creation, number one in investment, not in the back of the pack. So I'll ask you again, you sat there at the cabinet table, Minister. Why don't you move to the front of the line, menu at McDonald's and an animal welfare 24/7 line instead of creating jobs for men and women?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I know the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment will want to comment on this, but you know, let's play a little bit of compare and contrast, Mr. Speaker. Let's look at the so-called PC white papers. You know what they would do, Mr. Speaker? They would result in the firing of 10,000 education workers. They would result in the firing of 2,000 health care workers. They would drive down wages in this province with their harmful right to work for less legislation. And Mr. Speaker, we found out on the transit front that the Leader of the Opposition's back of the envelope plan, which Mayor Hazel McCallion came out swinging against this morning, by the way, Mr. Speaker, it would result in the cancellation of transit plans across this region, which in turn would lead to lower economic growth and also affect infrastructure. Mr. Speaker, we have a plan, not like the half-baked plan that the Leader of the Opposition puts forward, which would only result in job losses in this province.
Final supplementary.
Well, you know, again, I've asked where the jobs plan is. We had a deal. I thought we had a deal. And you've reneged on this deal. You've not brought forward any new ideas to create jobs. I don't understand, you know, why you're putting forward these other initiatives instead of helping people in manufacturing get a good job so they can put bread on the table for the family. So we've lost 300,000 manufacturing jobs. Your finance minister has said that growth is actually slowing in the province of Ontario. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of Ontario falling behind. I'm tired of young men and young women having to leave this province to go to Saskatchewan and Alberta to get a good job. I'm tired of businesses leaping over Ontario to go to the States or other provinces to open up. I want to see this in Ontario. We have a plan. We're ready to put it out there. We can turn this province around. What's wrong with
you?
Where is your plan? Bring it forward. Will we actually see it on November 7th? Or are you kicking this down the road once again?
You see it, please? You see it, please?
Thank you. Minister.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment, Mr. Speaker.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I mean, it's unfortunate that the leader of the official opposition continues to talk down Ontario's economy. And while he does that, over on this side, we are creating jobs. And as was referenced already, nearly 500,000 jobs have been created since the bottom of the recession. 90% of those, 95% of those jobs actually are full-time jobs. About 80% of them are in the private sector as well. We've created a new trade strategy just a few weeks ago that we released. I guess the official opposition wasn't listening to that, or our new social enterprise strategy that's going to be creating thousands of jobs as well. Our youth job strategy, $295 million over the next 2 years, which is estimated to create at least 30,000 jobs. So we've been working hard on this side. In fact, when you think of our Eastern Ontario and Southwestern Ontario development funds, created and retained more than 22,000 jobs. We've contributed as a government
$1 billion,
leveraged almost $1 billion from the private sector.
Thank you. New question. The leader of the...
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the acting premier today. I guess I'll make this point again. Economic Development Trade Minister rhymes off all kinds of government spending programs financed by higher taxes on families and businesses. I'd argue you've tried that for 10 years. Our growth rate is slowing. We're at the back of the pack in job creation. Isn't it time to try another plan? Let me tell you another impact of the Liberal mismanagement of our economy. Today is actually the four-year anniversary date of our credit downgrade.
Oh, yeah.
Under the Liberals of Kathleen Wynne, we've had three consecutive credit rating downgrades. I'm proud to say under a PC government, we actually had 9 credit improvements and upgrades in the province of Ontario, a contrast that any day. So let me ask you, now that we're at the four-year anniversary of our credit rating downgrade,
question.
What have you actually done to get us an upgrade? Why aren't we moving forward instead of falling farther and farther backward in our great province?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, when we came to office, we inherited a secret $5.6 billion deficit. And that member sat around the cabinet table. And allowed the Magna budget to come forward with that hidden deficit. Mr. Speaker,
the member from Simcoe North come to order. The member from Thunder Bay, I'm trying to do something here. Thank you. The member from Simcoe North will come to order. Finish.
Mr. Speaker, we cleaned up that deficit, and during the recession, Mr. Speaker, we invested significantly, as did every government across this country, including their cousins in Ottawa, indeed every government across the world. We are right now in the fourth year, Mr. Speaker, of seeing that deficit be reduced in a responsible fashion and not engaging in the slashing and burning that is the hallmark of that.
Thank you. Supplementary.
I had hoped on a very serious issue, we get a more serious response from the House. This is the four-year anniversary of the third credit rating. No, the original. We've had three credit rating downgrades under the Liberals. Now, let me tell you why this is important. It's just like your credit score. The worse rating you have, the more difficult it is to borrow, to finance a mortgage, to get a car. Now, that means for the province of Ontario, we're paying more in debt interest, which means less money for doctors or for nurses.
Yep.
I'd rather see us invest in priorities like health care than send it to our overseas lenders. Very straightforward point. So can we expect, Minister, in the economic statement that you announced for November 7th, a comprehensive plan to actually reduce spending and improve Ontario's credit score, or are we just going to get more of the same?
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker, when it comes to program spending. Let me share some of the stats here. With program spending, we now have an annual rate of less than 1% on average, which we're projecting forward between now and 2017-18. We're continuing to move forward with 60% of the Drummond recommendations this year. We are transforming public services for better results. Mr. Speaker, we have brought down the deficit year after year in a responsible way, Mr. Speaker. We haven't engaged in the type of slashing and burning that has been the hallmark of the PC party. I've read those white papers, Mr. Speaker, and they scare me, Mr. Speaker. They are shades of what Mike Harris and the Leader of the Opposition did to this province. And, Mr. Speaker, we need a responsible way. We need to get the deficit under control, but we are going to do it in a way that rejects what happened in the past, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, again, I'll stress, Minister, 4 years on, the credit rating remains downgraded. There is no hope for an upgrade. That's not the case in Alberta or British Columbia, where they've maintained AAA credit ratings. Saskatchewan has an upgrade. You say you blame the international crisis. Well, other provinces have actually moved forward. Ontario is falling further and further behind. Now, look, I know that your caucus is in a bit of a dispute. You want to kick up the balanced budget date farther past 2018. At least those caucus members are being honest, because you have no plan to balance the books. But you know what? I say that's not good enough. We put a plan on the table to actually get spending under control, to balance our books, to pay down debt. That's what we need for economic growth. So I'll ask you one time, because I assume that you've been at the cabinet table, you had a preview. Please don't tell us that November 7th you're going to kick this can down the road even more. We can't afford
Question.
It. I want jobs in Ontario, not going out of Ontario. Will you at least implement our plan if you have no clue on how to get
Thank there? Thank you.
Acting Premier.
Mr. Speaker, we have seen their plan before. It involves selling Highway 407 at bargain basement prices, Mr. Speaker. The fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, that governments around the world invested significantly and, yes, drove up deficits during a time of recession, one of the worst recessions to hit the Western world since the 1930s. And we are in the process of reducing the deficit, Mr. Speaker. We are doing it in a balanced way. We are not engaging in the slashing and burning of the opposition, Mr. Speaker. We are holding government spending tight. We are restraining wages. And, Mr. Speaker, we are finding ways to work together to make sure that we reach that target of 2017-18 in a responsible way. And the honourable member will hear more on November the 7th.
Thank you. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Energy. Families and businesses paying some of the highest electricity rates in Canada are tired of getting hit with the cost of electricity decisions that are being made behind closed doors. Is the Liberal government ready to take some simple, concrete steps to ensure real accountability and transparency to folks who are stuck paying the bills?
Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I'd want to say, first of all, that when we took over government, there was a deficit in electricity infrastructure. We've invested, Mr. Speaker, $21 billion in generation. We've invested $10 billion in new transmission and upgraded transmission. We have converted 25% coal generation, which they've created, to zero coal generation in the province. In the meantime, Mr. Speaker, we have taken some very positive steps, which the NDP has voted against in terms of mitigating electricity prices, including, Mr. Speaker, the Ontario Clean Energy Benefit, which provides a 10% discount to families, small businessmen and farmers, Mr. Speaker, the Energy and Property Tax Credit, the Northern Ontario Energy Credit, and they voted against every single one of them, every single price mitigation, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, people are tired of seeing this government sign electricity contracts and make electricity decisions without any concern for the people who are stuck paying the bills. We know the government wasted over $1 billion on cancelled
The Minister of Rural Affairs come to order.
In Oakville and Mississauga. The Ontario Auditor General was able to get us some answers on that, Speaker, but we still don't know how much money the government spent signing contracts for nuclear power plants that they just finished scrapping. The government says it spent $180 million, Speaker, but all we know is that the game around here tends to be how high can we go. Yep. And so what we not want to know is if the government, if this minister, will provide some transparency.
Question.
And tell the auditor to actually review the books on the cancelled plans.
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party references our decision to defer new nuclear and the costs that may have been incurred in preparation for that, Mr. Speaker. First of all, deferring new nuclear was the right decision. It's received support across the province. It is going to save us, Mr. Speaker, an investment of $15 billion in the system, which otherwise would be creating new power, which we don't need because we've created a surplus situation. The $180 million that she's referring to, Mr. Speaker, has been invested in environmental approvals, project planning, public and stakeholder consultations around the new build. It's enabled us to obtain a 10-year license to build new nuclear should we decide to move in that direction under our new long-term energy plan. If we've been responsible, Mr.
Answer.
Speaker, and the $15 billion not being spent in new nuclear will mitigate rate increases, which is exactly the point that she's talking about.
Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, people deserve some basic answers on the sky-high cost of electricity, and all they get from their government is evasion and excuses. New Democrats have asked the Premier to appear at the Justice Committee to explain new revelations by the auditor that she signed off on an arbitration, which the auditor said favoured a private power company and drove up costs for Ontarians. The Premier said she won't come this Thursday. Can the minister tell us when the Premier will actually walk the walk on transparency and come to the Gas Plant Committee to answer questions about her role in the arbitration agreement specifically highlighted by the auditor?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the Premier has been very open and transparent. She's been to committee. She has taken very significant initiatives on transparency, the closing documents, going to the committee. Mr. Speaker, what the people of Ontario want to know is, what is the NDP party policy on energy? What is your policy on renewables? What is your policy on wind? What is your policy on renewing for refurbishment of the units? More particularly, Mr. Speaker, what she is really, really upset about is the fact that we have been inundated by her supporters for our decision on deferring new nuclear. We have hundreds, if not thousands, of congratulations and thank you. We're stealing her thunder, and she won't talk about the deferral of new new nuclear, Mr. Speaker.
New question. Leader of the third party.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My next question is actually to the Acting Premier. I want to ask a question about another issue that's hitting household budgets pretty hard these days. Drivers in Ontario are paying some of the highest auto insurance in the country, and the government is letting those rates continue to climb in Ontario. So rates aren't going anywhere but up for drivers. Does the Acting Premier think it's fair that drivers are forced to pay the cost of testing and retesting their cars now, even when their cars are meeting all appropriate emission standards?
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, in terms of auto insurance, we've been very, very clear. We brought forward a plan, Mr. Speaker. It was a well-thought-out plan, which involves cooperation with the industry, where we plan to see auto insurance premiums reduced by an average of 15% over the next 2 years. These changes, Mr. Speaker, they build on our existing plan, the plans that have been in place, and we have set out benchmarks. The Minister of Finance has reported on this to the Legislature, benchmarks that we we'll see over the coming months as we see auto insurance rates reduced here in the province of Ontario. Mr. Speaker,
it's
a plan that is, as I say, based upon consultation with the industry. It has a number of elements, and over time we are going to achieve real results for the drivers here in the province of Ontario.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, the point of the Drive Clean program was to reduce smog and air pollution. But the program is failing more new cars that produce less smog and failing fewer older cars that are producing more smog and forcing drivers to pay for retesting even when the problem is with the testing equipment, not the car. This is a program that isn't producing results and is making life more expensive for Ontarians, Speaker. Does the acting Premier think that that's fair?
The Minister of the Environment, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would have expected that those who would be opposed to this program environmentally would be asking this question. I must say I'm surprised that the leader of the New Democratic Party is asking this specific question. She would know, for instance, that the Ontario Medical Association believes that this program is an excellent program, that the Ontario Lung Association believes that it's essential, that the Asthma Association believes it's essential. Gideon Foreman, Executive Director of the Canadian Association for Physicians of the Environment, says programs like Drive Clean, which reduce smog components and poisons such as carbon monoxide, are very important to public health.
Sir.
Our doctors believe that far from being eliminated, these programs should be strengthened, and that's precisely what is happening.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, I think the minister avoided the question about whether or not the program is actually effective, Speaker, in terms of the testing, which was the question. People feel like they're being squeezed in tough financial times, Speaker. The government promised that auto insurance rates would come down, but of course the government keeps dragging their feet and people keep seeing increases. The government is giving $1 billion HST break to corporations, and every day people are being told they'll be getting a bill for new taxes and new tolls that will cost $1,000 a year. The government told people that Drive Clean would be revenue neutral and it would make sure we would reduce smog in our air, but it's failing clean cars and passing dirty cars, and people are worrying what the heck they're paying for, Speaker. Does the acting Premier think this program is actually working?
Question, thank you. Minister of the Environment.
Well, once again, I must express, I know the New Democratic Party's going through a bit of a change here where they want to take on the populist stance, where they want to take on the consumer stance. I understand that, at the sacrifice to the environmental programs that we have in place. Many of the Auditor General's suggestions, for instance, for program improvement are captured in the recent program changes. She would know that there are 33 jurisdictions, I believe, in North America that have exactly the same program. It is a more precise test. It is a better test. It's identifying problems.
Answer.
I'm really, really surprised that the New Democratic Party, and I know their critics must be cringing and hearing this, is taking this particular stance in a program that is reducing dramatically the emissions.
New question. The member from Barrie.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister responsible for Pan Am Games. Minister, Ontarians have a right to know how much the Pan Am Games are going to cost them. We were all led to believe by the bid book that the total cost for the Pan Am Games would be about $1.4 billion, with other partners, as you continue to point out. But the issue is that the Ontario Liberal government has tacked on an extra $1.1 billion in costs. What is that?
That's a familiar number.
Liberal scandal number? A magic Liberal scandal number?
I've heard that before.
Pan Am projects like the Athletes Village, the Air Rail Link, the Secretariat money, the hidden Secretariat money, the Pan Am Trail, not including Security and Transportation Minister, they're all outside the original budget. Minister, what is the total of the Pan Am Games? Do you have a number? And if not, why not?
How much?
The Minister responsible for the 2015
Thank you, Speaker, for the question. I thought later on tonight, having a more detailed debate with the honourable member, but that was cancelled for the night, so I wonder why it was cancelled. Anyhow, Speaker, my ministry is working hard on two pieces at the moment. One is the transportation, the other one is the security. Speaker, the transportation is a complex file. You know the footprint is quite large. It involves 10,000 kilometers square. And 14 local governments. Speaker, at the moment, some of our current planning priorities include establishing a safe and reliable route network for athletes and officials, strategies to handle an influx of spectators, and integrated signing plan and other ways to ensure successful game transportation. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Somebody's got to herd some cats over there. I don't get it.
Minister, it is a complex file, and that's why it's disturbing you don't have a grip on it. We'd love an answer to these simple questions. What is the cost to Ontarians? The stock answer that you've been given is going to become even more embarrassing once we get the documents for the estimates on November 19th. It's not just your doublespeak, Minister, that's the problem. It's that you're giving away more of our money as opposed to executives.
Withdraw, please. Withdraw, please.
Withdrawn. Withdrawn, Speaker. It's that you're giving away more of our money as a bonus to executives for a false budget. Your budget is 2 years out of date and severely flawed, Minister. But despite your smoke and mirrors, we've confirmed at least an additional $1.1 billion for Pan Am. Minister, you continue to misinform the public about the total cost.
Member will withdraw.
Really? Okay, withdrawn. Withdrawn. You refuse to answer transportation costs and think the sky's the limit of security. Minister, you're not accountable. Will you step down today and let someone else do it?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Thank you very much for the question. Speaker, the member is the king of the creation of nonsense numbers. He is the king of fabrication of stories that undermine the Pan-American game. Speaker, the member opposite wants to cut the ties with 41 countries. He wants to take away the 26,000 jobs we're going to create. He wants to destroy the capital project so far we have built, and he wants to dampen the spirit of the competitors. Speaker, he wants to demolish all the legacy of the Pan and Paraguay.
Member from Prince Edward Hastings, come to order.
Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Essex.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Rural Affairs. Speaker, the Premier charges that the Slots at Racetrack program wasn't accountable, but she's the one that is keeping racetrack audits top secret. Not-for-profit track operators like the Fort Erie Racetrack have opened their books because they have nothing to hide, and now they're the ones getting cut out of the Liberal plan because of their honesty. When will the Premier make the audits public so that we can see how much for-profit giants like Woodbine spent on bonuses, perks, reserves, and executive compensation?
Well, Mr. Speaker, our goal is to have a sustainable horse racing industry in the province of Ontario. Our government has a plan to invest in people and infrastructure and support an innovative, dynamic environment where business can succeed. That's why we created a new $400 million five-year horse racing partnership plan under the auspices of Mr. Snowblood, Mr. Buchanan, and Mr. Wilkinson. We believe that our horse racing sustainability plan will strengthen and promote live racing in the province of Ontario. It will stabilize the industry and grow both the fan base and the wagering revenues. It will also be, Mr. Speaker, I emphasize, accountable, transparent, and provide a positive return on investment of public funds. The plan also calls for restructured governance in the province of Ontario. Collaboration and cooperation will be critical in moving forward a horse racing plan that's integrated with the OLG's modernization plan, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the Minister of Rural Affairs. The Premier has a panel on horse racing, and she has a panel on openness. But she'd rather not say how much Woodbine executives paid themselves with SART money meant for horses, because this government knows how to back their own winner. And it knows how to turn its back on horse people and track workers in Fort Erie and communities all across rural Ontario. Speaker, my question is simple. Will the government come clean and make the track audits public, yes or no?
Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I was in Leamington last Friday, and there's a positive buzz in Leamington for the future horse racing in that community. We have recognized for over a year that the Slots at Racetracks program was unaccountable and lacked transparency. That's why we canceled
it.
The program was reviewed by Siditsky, Drummond, and our transition.
Member asked the question.
The previous track books were reviewed by third-party audits. The Auditor General is currently looking at the program. This is not an area that lacks scrutiny across the province of Ontario. We've learned a lesson from the previous PC program, and we set in place a new modern program, transparable, accountable, and a pathway for the future, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Oak Ridges Markham.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and my question through you is also to the Minister of Rural Affairs. Minister, Ontario's small and rural communities have many unique and diverse challenges when it comes to economic development and small business growth. Currently, there are a number of programs designed to assist rural municipalities with these challenges, such as the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund and the Eastern Ontario Development Fund. Although these programs address many important priorities, there is always room to do more. A program that was very popular in my community and in many others across Ontario was the Rural Economic Development, or RED, program. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister of Rural Affairs, could the Minister please update the House on what our government is doing to strengthen and diversify the economies of rural communities?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Rural Affairs.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Oak Ridges Markham for asking me that question. And just recently, I was in her community to celebrate the Markham Fall Fair, which was a wonderful event for that community. Our government is committed to working with rural stakeholders to build strong, vibrant and rural communities and businesses throughout Ontario. One way we're meeting this goal is through the relaunch of the Rural Economic Development Program. The relaunch program is now accepting applications for $4.5 million available this fiscal year. The RED program helps our rural municipalities, including Oak Ridges Markham, and to create jobs and attract investment by promoting innovative partnerships. Since 2003, the RED program, our government has invested over $167 billion in 418 projects, generated over $1.2 billion in economic activity, supported the creation or retention of over 35,000 jobs. Moving forward, the RED reflects our government's renewed commitment to rural Ontario.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that answer. Constituents in my great riding of Oak Ridges Markham will be pleased to hear that our government is continuing to invest in the RED program. I know firsthand that in the past, small businesses in my riding from the town of Whitchurch Stouffville and the township of King have benefited from both business retention and expansion projects through the RED program. Previously, RED focused on initiatives that included downtown revitalization and the food processing sector development. And I'm sure my constituents and others from rural communities across the province will be interested in understanding the focus of the relaunched program. Speaker, through you to the Minister, could the Minister please elaborate on what kinds of projects RED will be focused on?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member for a supplementary. The RED program is focused on those high-value, low-cost projects that create jobs and diversify economies in rural Ontario. Projects could include downtown revitalization, regional marketing and promotion, business development and diversification and community expansion, to name a few. I encourage all rural municipalities to take a look at the relaunched RED program to see how it can help them with their priorities. Applications are available online or by contacting my ministry directly. Rural Ontario communities deserve a real focus by this government. By renewing our commitment to the RED program, our government is supporting a dynamic and innovative business climate in all corners of the province of Ontario, working to build a successful and vibrant One Ontario. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
Good question.
Yes, thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of the Environment. Minister, it's now been almost a full year since the Auditor General warned you that collecting a surplus on a revenue-neutral program like Drive Clean is an illegal tax. But instead of following the Auditor General's advice, you nearly doubled the surplus of the Drive Clean program. That's right. Under the Liberal government, Ontarians are now paying, wait for it, $19 million in illegal Drive Clean taxes every year. This needs to be corrected now. Minister, simple question. Will you commit to ending this illegal tax grab today?
Here, here. Good question.
Minister of the Environment.
Well, I know that the Conservative Party has been attacking the program, despite the fact that when the changes are made to the program, people such as Gord Miller, the Environmental Commissioner of Ontario, said in his 2011-2012 report, the Drive Clean program has undergone a number of independent program reviews that concluded significant reductions in smog-causing pollutants were being achieved but that further reductions could result from program improvements, including the implementation of onboard diagnostic emission testing, which is currently underway and which is conducted in over 30 jurisdictions in North America. So we're not unique in that
answer.
At all. And so I'm very surprised that the member continues to attack the program, which is, in fact, taking 36,000 tons of smog out of our air every year and stopping the contribution of 2,500 premature deaths a year, according to the Ontario Medical Association.
The member from Leeds, Grenville, will come to order.
So I'm surprised that the member continues to attack a program which is improving the air quality in this province measurably.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Minister, I'll get you to put your earpiece in here. I'm talking about the surplus here, not about the program itself. And we all know the program that you brought in is not about protecting the environment. In fact, it's all about the money.
Surplus.
And in fact, the,
all about the money.
The courts have ruled that you cannot
make
money off a revenue-neutral program. So it's not acceptable
to
continue to ignore the Auditor General's advice until your next budget, as was reported last night on CTV. That's like getting caught for pickpocketing and then telling the police you'll stop in a few months from now. Speaker, wrongdoing should be corrected immediately, not when the perpetrator feels like it. It's not right to make Ontarians pay illegal taxes for one more day, especially for a temporary program that is long past its expiry date. So, Minister, will you commit to ending the illegal drive clean surplus and pay back the excess money collected to Ontario drivers today?
Yeah, good idea.
Excuse me. I'm trying to get attention. Thank you. And the need for an earpiece would not be necessary if the heckling stopped. Carry on.
The member would be aware, of course, that the program was in fact established by the Conservative government in 1999. Was in fact in deficit for the first decade of the program. In other words, it was a net cost to the province of Ontario for this program, and only at the end of 2011 was it concluded that it had become revenue neutral. Now we look forward. What happens is, and by the way, I should say this, because your leader, who is a member of the cabinet, will remember this, the only raise in the cost of the fee came from, you'll guess it, the Conservative Party.
No way.
The Conservative government raised it from $30 to $35. Now,
sir,
I have asked and I'm working with the Minister of Finance to ensure that this program becomes, as it is designed to be, revenue neutral. And I
thank you. I'm disturbed by some of the heckling I'm now hearing, and I'll act quickly for it to stop. New question. The member from Algoma, Manitoulin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good morning to you. My question is to the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. In May of 2012, the Premier said, and I quote, "In order for the Ring of Fire to go forward in the best way possible, we know that this is a partnership. The federal government, First Nations, the provincial government, and the companies working together," end quote. Yet just 2 weeks ago, Cliffs was forced to consider pulling out of the Ring of Fire because this government refuses to provide direction in Ring of Fire development. And last Friday, Northern Superior Resources was forced to sue the government for failing to play a role in consultations with First Nations. How can this government ask partners to work together while itself refuses to play a role in creating a plan for mining development and job creation?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question, and I think as the member understands very well, we are indeed working with all our partners very, very closely. We're certainly involved in very significant, important discussions, if not negotiations, with the Metabo First Nations, something that we hope will lead us towards a much greater opportunity to work together with them as well on a number of issues that are very important. We're working in terms of skills upgrading and skills training to have people people prepared for the Ring of Fire. We're certainly also working with the federal government as well, trying to get them to play a true partnership role. And may I say, with the companies, we continue to work closely in a focused way with all the companies, Cliff Natural Resources, Noront Resources, and KWG Resources. So this is a complicated project, one that will make such a difference to so many over so many years, a multi-generational opportunity, and indeed that's the opportunity that we have to work together with the work that obviously all of us can do here in the legislature together.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Again, my question to the minister. Minister, last week you said that we're having discussions with all interested companies. Those discussions obviously will include important infrastructure links. The government is announcing thousands of jobs will come to the province, but yet no work on the ground is being done to create these jobs. There is no training of the workforce to meet the demand. There is no plan for infrastructure, and there is no electricity rate reductions. For 6 years, this government has talked the talk, but has done nothing on the ground to create the jobs and consult the communities. What will it take for this government to actually develop a plan for Ring of Fire development and job creation in the north?
Thank you.
Well, yes, sir. The member could not be more wrong in almost every aspect of what he just referenced. Certainly, in terms of the skills training upgrading, we've provided skills training upgrade to over 800 people. We've consulted on a number of bases with First Nation communities, as well as all kinds of other northern municipal leaders, as well, and a variety of aspects as well. In terms of the companies, we recognize how important infrastructure is, and that's why we are looking very closely at a variety of options. Our obligation and what your expectation would be that we make an appropriate assessment to say what is the best decision in terms of the role the province should be playing in terms of infrastructure. And that's exactly what we're doing. And that's why we're going to continue to work as closely as we can with CLIPS and with the other companies and with NORM and KWG. I think you recognize what a complex project. It's a multifaceted project, but one that we are extremely excited about, continue to be excited about, continue to view as a real priority.
Thank you.
And one that I will
New question, the member from Mississauga, Brampton South.
Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Transportation. Constituents in my riding of Mississauga, Brampton South constantly contact me at my constituency office to find out about improvements to public transit in Mississauga and Brampton. Speaker, my constituents face worst gridlock in the province and can spend over 1 to 2 hours commuting to and from work. And yesterday, the mayor of Mississauga expressed her concern on the recent comments by the leader of the opposition on cancelling a planned LRT project in Mississauga, a project that would get residents moving. Speaker, now my constituents are worried about the future of projects in Peel. Can the minister please assure them that better transit is on the way?
Thank you, Minister Transportation.
Thank you very much. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for her constant and unwavering support for the Huron-Ontario LRT and the five projects, rapid transit projects, we have going on in Peel Region right now, Mr. Speaker. And Mayor McKelly is quite right and has led a boom in commercial development and residential development as a result of these, which the cancellation of them would mean the major loss of jobs in that. But you know, Mr. Speaker, I got my hands on the Conservatives' election strategy in Peel Region. And they've got a new set of slogans, Mr. Speaker. The MPP for Etobicoke Lakeshore is going to be running on a slogan called Down with Up. The MPP for Durham will be running on the slogan Slim Pickens for Pulse. The MPPs for Caledon and Dufferin is running on a slogan of Zero for Zoom. And the MPPs for Thornhill and Newmarket Aurora are running on the catchy slogan, Mr. Speaker, Hasta la Vista Viva. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for the clarification. My constituents will be happy to know this. Government is committed to better public transit and supporting municipalities with the initiatives like this. Speaker, what my constituents want to know more about the transit projects in Mississauga and Brampton and how they fit in our government's investment strategy. Can the minister tell us more on the LRT and BRT projects they are under consideration in the region of Peel?
Cabinet Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the official opposition not only has no jobs plan, no economic development plan, they have an anti-investment plan. Cancelling rapid transit in Kitchener, Hamilton, Mississauga, Brampton, Oshawa, Scarborough would devastate commercial investment. We have, it's interesting the construction trades are here, Mr. Speaker, because we've been working very hard with them on apprenticeship programs, on community benefits. All of these people here today, Mr. Speaker, are counting on hundreds of thousands of person years for pipe fitters and electricians and iron workers, Mr. Speaker. He is cutting their throats, he is eliminating their jobs, and he is undermining the regional economies of this province, Mr. Speaker. That is economic incompetence. That is not a jobs plan. That is a jobs killing plan, Mr. Speaker. He wants people.
You seated, please. You seated, please. I would be remiss if I did not remind the member and all members, particularly when questions asked of government policy, that it should be woven with government policy, and that in the next round I will be listening carefully to ensure that that takes place. New question. The Leader of the Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
My question to the Acting Premier. We're going to continue our pursuit of a new hospital for residents of South Niagara. We're on side with folks in Niagara Falls, Fort Erie, Polk River Welland, who want to see a new site. You've already cancelled the Wesley Memorial site. And it seems that, Minister, the Liberals under Kathleen Wynne almost seem to believe that when you cross the Burlington Skyway, you've entered into New York State. So let me make the case of why this is valuable. Your own advisor, Kevin Smith, has said you actually save money here. It's $285 million cheaper to build a modern facility in Niagara Falls than to keep the existing sites open. He also makes the case that you can save $10 million a year in administration that you can actually then put into hiring more nurses and attracting more doctors. So I ask you, what's not to like about this plan?
Question.
It saves money, it improves care, and it's on side with hardworking families in South Niagara. Why are you against it?
Mr. Speaker, I think the Minister of Health has commented on this. There obviously is a debate within the Niagara community about this issue, and I think the member knows, the Leader of the Opposition knows, there are many steps that must be taken before the government can make decisions on a new capital project such as this, including the submission of a proposal, and we're currently reviewing the NHS's proposal. Funding is up at the NHS. It's receiving over $330 million this year, $127 million increase since 2003,
and the
represents 62%.
And
Mr. Speaker, as my friend, the Minister of the Environment, reminds me constantly, we've invested in a new state-of-the-art hospital to replace the existing St. Catharines General site and Ontario Street site.
It's
a 375-bed facility, offers acute and critical inpatient services, surgical, emergency, and ambulatory services for residents of St. Catharines, Thorold.
Thank you. Supplementary.
But, Minister, if you agree the case for North Niagara, why are you against it for South Niagara and West Niagara? Why are you picking sides based on if the riding is represented by a Liberal or is it represented by somebody else? I think these interests should be done in the best interests of health care for local residents. Kevin Smith is your advisor. He's made the recommendation. It's sat on your desk for over a year. So the NDP has made their position clear. They're against it. They've called it preposterous. But at least they have a position. It's got to be awfully difficult sitting on that fence for a year now, Minister. In fact, over a year. That's got to hurt. So get off the fence, make a decision, and please don't tell us you're going to have another panel to study a previous panel. Get off the fence, make the call. I know where we stand. We support the hospital in Niagara Falls. Why don't you? Do you really think Niagara's part of New York State, or will you make the right decision
for
the people of South Niagara?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Acting Premier.
You know, Mr. Speaker, I wasn't around to know the process that took place when the Leader of the Opposition, when he was in government, closed 28 hospitals, Mr. Speaker. But I do know, Mr. Speaker, from reading the PC white paper, that they are, their plan calls for the firing of 2,000 nurses, Mr. Speaker, which once again marks shades of the Harris government, where we saw cuts to health care, we saw increased waiting times. The fact of the matter, Mr. Speaker, is that under our watch, we have seen increases in the number of new hospitals and hospital refurbishments across Ontario. And I'd invite the Leader of the Opposition, ask his colleague from Simcoe North about the Waypoint Centre for Mental Health Care, ask his colleague from Barrie about the Royal Victoria Hospital expansion. Ask his friend from Cambridge about the Cambridge Hospital redevelopment. From Burlington about the Joseph Brand Memorial Hospital expansion. Halton, the Milton District Hospital expansion. Mr. Speaker, I could go on.
No, you won't. New question. The member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Labour. Nick Lalonde was a young father, husband, and worker. He died from a fall at a construction site in my riding just over 3 weeks ago. On Christmas Eve 2009, four workers in Toronto were killed when the scaffolding they were working on collapsed. Yep. The subsequent investigation into workplace safety, led by Tony Dean, recommended, among other changes, the introduction of mandatory fall prevention safety training for workers. As the minister knows, the development of that fall prevention safety standard and regulation has been going on for a number of years now. When does this government expect the heights training regulation to come into force?
Thank you, Minister Labour.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Speaker. And I thank the member opposite for asking a very important question and an incident that I'm very much aware about in her community in Waterloo, and was very sad to hear about this particular incident. Every incident that we hear when somebody at work is injured or worse, Speaker, loses their life. The member opposite, Speaker, also knows that our respective offices have been in touch about this issue frequently since the incident had been taking place. There is an active investigation right now going on looking at the causes. Health and safety and prevention is the number one priority of this government, and we are working very hard, Speaker, in consultation with all our partners from industry to building trades in implementing the recommendations of the expert panel, and there will be some very good news coming forward in terms of all the priority recommendations and the recommendations
Thank
that were
you.
Outlined by the Dean panel.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Again to the Minister of Labour. On December 16, 2010, then Minister Fonseca wholeheartedly embraced the Health and Safety Expert Advisory Panel's recommendation that a heights training regulation be enforced by December 2011. That's nearly 2 years ago, Minister, not 2 years from now. Last Thursday, it was reported that a heights training standard was developed in 2010, but never enacted. Since June of this year, Nick Lalonde and eight other workers in Ontario have fallen to their deaths. Since 2010, the Ministry of Labour has failed to implement a life-saving regulation that was essentially ready to go. Will this government bring a heights training regulation into force immediately and start saving lives on Ontario's construction sites?
Answer question. Thank you. Answer.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Speaker, I'm very proud that this legislature unanimously voted on the recommendations that were outlined by the Dean panel. As a result, Speaker, we have created the very first chief prevention officer in the province in here in Ontario, across the whole entire country. And George Grisiotis, the chief prevention officer, is working very hard along with the Prevention Council on a prevention strategy that will be coming out soon. We'll be also, Speaker, will be announcing mandatory awareness training for all workers and supervisors across the province, something that this House agreed on.
Here, here.
And, Speaker, we are actively consulting right now with the industry, with the workers, on working at heights regulations, the regulations that the member ops is speaking about, and also mandatory construction training for all construction workers as well. And soon, Speaker,
yes,
we'll be looking for their support when we bring forward those regulations.
Here,
thank
here,
you very
here,
much.
Here.
Thank you. New question, the member from Oakville.
Thank you. I've got a question this morning, Speaker, for the Minister of Government Services. He will know that throughout the world, all governments at the local, provincial and federal levels have been opening up vast sets of data to the public for free. These data sets are made available to the public for them to use as they see fit. Without the restrictions of copyright or patent, these data sets can be used to spark innovation, assist in problem solving, or even spur development in the creative economy. Speaker, I understand that our government recently announced an initiative that builds on Ontario's support of this global movement. When government data is made available to the public, it's got the potential to support a dynamic and a very innovative business climate. Speaker, would the minister please explain to the House what steps the government is currently taking in the area of the issue of open data?
Thank you, Minister of Government Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I thank the member for the question. The open data and the open data movement, Mr. Speaker, is international. It's about making non-confidential data accessible so that innovators, entrepreneurs, journalists, members of the public can use it, manipulate it is the term, link it to others. The term, again, is mash it, analyze it, and use it to solve problems that affect all of us in our everyday lives. For example, Ontario citizens can now look at data such as geological surveys, road repairs, how much money visitors to the provinces spend here, and how many Ontario residents visited overseas countries. They can find out enrollment for every public and Catholic school in the province. Now, Mr. Speaker, we are already well on our way. In November 2012, we launched an open data catalogue that can be found at www.ontario.ca/opendata, and we have more than 170 data sets that are available Sir. Online for businesses and the public to use free of charge, Mr. Speaker, with no copyright restrictions.
Thank
they
you.
Can use them as they see fit.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. It's encouraging to see our government's taking these steps to make data available to the public and to build and to add to this global movement. Now, Speaker, I know the government's got a plan to help businesses at many levels succeed while also drawing investment into the province. Finding new ways to innovate is often a great economic stimulator. Showing businesses that we're supporting them through open data is a great way to spark and encourage innovation. I know in my riding of Oakville specifically, there are companies in many sectors that could use this data to create even more jobs. Wow. Speaker, when we support an innovative business climate, we ensure businesses come, invest in, and help grow Ontario's economy. So through you to the minister again, how will open data work? What kind of jobs or businesses opportunities will it create
Question.
For the people of this province?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the Open Data Catalogue is making it easier for citizens and businesses to find and benefit from information that the government has collected. By sharing data, Ontario is encouraging innovation, economic development, and job creation. Let me give you a few examples. The Ontario Road Safety Annual Report, which is available on the MTO website, is used by road safety and injury prevention organizations, such as the Traffic Injury Research Foundation, to conduct various studies related to road safety. Other stakeholders that use this database include MAD, Arrive Alive, and the CAA. One data set that we added in July 2013 shows where vital utilities are located around the province, such as for electricity and water, communications,
Answer.
Heating, fuel, and fiber optic stations. This kind of information is very useful for companies that are deciding where to locate. Mr. Speaker, there are a myriad of examples, and they will continue to grow over the
Thank
coming
you.
Months.
Question, the member from Leeds, Grenville.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services. Minister, our party cleared the decks here so that the government can focus on what matters, jobs and the economy. Instead of creating jobs, your latest announcement to hand the OSPCA $5.5 million without accountability. Look, I care deeply about the welfare of animals. I also care very deeply about the human beings that are looking for work and are stuck paying the bills. Can you even tell me how you're going to measure whether Ontarians are getting any bang for those $5.5 million, or is this just another Liberal spending with no strings attached?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank the member from Leeds Grenville for his question. This was a wonderful announcement last Friday. Because I announced $5.5 million to the OSPCA, and the OSPCA will be able to improve the care of animals, the surveillance, and also they will be able to take action when animals will be mistreated. So they will be able to establish a 24-hour, 7 days a week centralized dispatch services. Good. They will be able to create a special squad
Answer.
Train investigator will crack down on puppy and kitten mills. They will be able to deliver a specialized livestock training for investigator.
Thank you. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much. Back to the minister. Ontarians have serious and legitimate questions about the OSPCA. They can't get basic answers regarding the organization's books, its investigation practices, or even the qualifications of its inspectors. You've handed them $5.5 million more to the OSPCA and done nothing to make them accountable to the hardworking Ontarians that are picking up the tab. The Premier talks a lot about open government, yet OSPCA remains cloaked in secrecy. Closed. Minister, can you tell me what specific measures you have put in place for the windfall to ensure that Ontarians have full disclosure about OSPCA's operations, investigations, and fundraising activities?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, first of all, Mr. Speaker, there will be a member of the ministry who will sit on the board, which was not happening in the past. We will also OSPCA will also provide a progress report to the government regularly. It will also note that the animal welfare team now have signed an MOU with the OSPCA and the agricultural sector to ensure the best possible expertise. We make sure that the money that we are investing will be to the benefits of the animal welfare in Ontario, and not like this party who were supporting a bill that will strip OSPCA of any oversight to the agriculture community. So we're not going to there. We'll make sure that there's...
Thank you. New question, the member from Parkdale Hyde Park.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment. On the 15th anniversary of the Ontario Legislators Disabilities Act resolution, the OADA Alliance is working to ensure the government actually keeps its promises. On January 22nd of this year, David Lepofsky, chair of the AODA Alliance, wrote to the Liberal government for information regarding the plans and actions to keep its election promise to effectively enforce the Act. After nearly 7 months, Mr. Speaker, with no response, Lepofsky had to resort to filing a Freedom of Information Act application. Finally, on October 2nd, he was told by the government that this information would cost him $2,325 plus possible additional fees. Why does the government believe it is acceptable to demand such an unreasonable sum from a volunteer organization that has no disposable funds?
Question.
How free is freedom of information?
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
I thank the member opposite for the question, and I've got the greatest respect for David Lepofsky. I've met with him as well, with members of the Alliance, and they do a fantastic job at making sure that this issue continues to be at the forefront of our society ambitions. And I know that we're working very hard as well to make sure that businesses, for example, the public sector has already complied fully with the legislative and regulatory requirements under the Act. Businesses as well, we're working hard, and I've made it a priority to make sure that they are doing their part on the various elements, the standards, the regulatory and legislative requirements that are there. And I also want, I mean, it gives me the opportunity to update the House as well on the important work, the status of the AODA reviewer, because as the legislature knows, every 5 years we're legally mandated to review it. Mayo Morin, the Dean of the Faculty of Law at the University of Toronto, is undertaking that important work right now.
Thank you. The Minister of Rural Affairs on a point of order.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I just want to correct my record. Earlier today, when I made a response regarding the RED program, Hansard says it was $4.5 billion for RED. I wish it was, but the exact figure is $4.5 billion. I just want to correct the record.
That is a point of order, and members are always allowed to correct their record. We have a deferred vote on the motion for third reading of Bill 74, an act to amend the Labour Relations Act 1995 to alter bargaining rights conferred by the pre-1980 working agreements in the construction industry. Call on the members. This will be a 5-minute bell. Would the members please take their seats? Would all members please take their seats? Please. On October the 28th, Mr. McNaughton moved third reading of Bill 74. All those in favor, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Fedeli.
Mr. Fedeli.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mrs. McLeod.
Mrs. McLeod.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Holliday.
Mr. Holliday.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Chudley.
Mr. Chudley.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. O'Toole.
Mr. O'Toole.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. McKenna.
Ms. McKenna.
Mr. Leone.
Mr. Leone.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Milligan.
Mr. Milligan.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Oh, look it over here.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mrs. Cansfield.
Mrs. Cansfield.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Malloy.
Mr. Malloy.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Gerritsen.
Mr. Gerritsen.
Mrs. Jeffrey.
Mrs. Jeffrey.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Bartolucci.
Mr. Bartolucci.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Ms. Peruzza.
Ms. Peruzza.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. McNeely.
Mr. McNeely.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Nackvi.
Mr. Nackvi.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Shubisong.
Ms. Shubisong.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Marchese.
Mr. Marchese.
Madame Gelina.
Madame Gelina.
Mr. Prue.
Mr. Prue.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Shine.
Mr. Shine.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
The ayes being 33, the nays being 60, I declare the motion lost. Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member from Barrie has given notice of his dissatisfaction with the answer to his question given by the minister responsible for the 2015 Pan-Parapan Games concerning the budget for the games. This matter will be debated tomorrow at 6 p.m. and I'd appreciate it very much if everyone stopped talking while I was trying to read a motion. And I'm also not impressed with people mentioning people's presence in this place. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recess until 3 p.m. this afternoon.